for joining us online. It is Easter Sunday, which means our God has risen and he's alive. Amen, church. Come on, we got so much to be grateful for. Come on, we praise him. Here we go.
Come, let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at his feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how his love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things.
Come on, church, he's done great things.
You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things. And I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. God, you do great things. Of mountain grandeur, creation's majesty, the glory of a sunrise shining over me. But the single greatest wonder my soul has ever seen is the Lamb of God on Calvary. Jesus. stars that reach me from distant galaxies. The oceans, they are speaking, magnificent, so deep. But still the greatest wonder my soul has ever seen is the Lamb of God on Calvary. Behold the Son of God, who takes away our sin. Behold His perfect sacrifice. Behold the wound of grace upon His hands and feet. Oh, the Lamb of God on Calvary. Heaven holds a welcome to all that's now unseen. Your love will be my anthem for all eternity, and the most enduring wonder my soul will ever see is the Lamb who conquered Calvary. Oh, the Lamb of God, a victory. Behold the Son of God, who takes away our sin. Behold His perfect sacrifice. Takes away our sin. Behold.
beginning. The line drawn in the sand. The end of all my striving. Now I am born again. That Jesus was forsaken. So I will never be. His grace is my salvation, the gift of God, the work of Calvary. It is done, it is finished. Christ has won, he is risen. Grace is here, love is strong.
church, can we lift up another shout of praise this morning? An opportunity to take communion together this morning. And so on your seat, you will find a small communion emblem, and you can begin to prepare that. You peel away the first layer to access the cracker, and then you can peel away the second layer to get access to the juice. And Matthew 28 gives an account of what happened on Resurrection Sunday. We read about Mary Magdalene, who went to go visit the tomb. And then when she got there, we read about the violent earthquake that shook the earth. And then an angel of the Lord appeared, and the stone rolled away, and the angel brings the good news. He isn't here, because he is risen. But there's a really tiny, teeny tiny little detail at the beginning of Matthew 28 that's so easy for us to look over, but I think it carries unique and special significance for us today. In verse 1, it says, early on Sunday morning, as the new day was dawning. And I don't know if you've ever heard the phrase dawn of a new day. It's actually an idiom, and it means a fresh start, a new beginning, an important and promising turning point. And this is exactly what Resurrection Sunday means for us. It's a foreshadowing of what was about to happen. A fresh start, a new beginning, an important and promising turning point. And so as we take communion this morning, we know that the cracker represents his body that was broken for us. And we know that the juice represents his blood that was shed. So we not only get to remember what Jesus did on the cross, but we get to celebrate the dawn of a new day. And so, church, can I encourage you, just take a moment as you take communion on your own, and let's celebrate. Celebrate for ourselves what this new beginning means for us. What a fresh start we have in Jesus. Do you remember the day that you were saved and what that means for you? So let's just take a moment and take communion on our own. If you haven't taken your communion yet, you can do that right now. And I'm just going to take a moment and pray for us. Lord Jesus, we thank you that we get to gather in your house today on Resurrection Sunday. God, thank you that this doesn't just represent any other normal day, Lord God, but this is a significant day for us as believers, Lord God. Thank you that we have a new day, that a new day has dawned, Lord God. Thank you that in you we have a fresh start, a new beginning, that this marks an important and special turning point in our lives. Lord God, thank you that you sent your Son to die on the cross so that we could have life and life to the full. And thank you for what that means for us today, a fresh start and a new beginning. And everybody in the room who was grateful for that said, amen. And amen. Well, church, it's good to be in the house with you this morning. And so before you take your seat, why don't you just turn around and high five someone standing next to you.
Well, good morning, everybody. It is Easter Sunday, and it is so good to be together in the house. It's a little bit cooler today. Yesterday was such a hot day. So wonderful to be together in the house. If this is your very first time at Urban Edge, we would just like to take a moment as a family and give you the warmest welcome. And then just to let you know, we are running a special in the cafe today. It is a toasted hot cross bun with cheese for just 10 Rand. So that's every opportunity to not rush off, stay for the good coffee, stay for the hot cross bun. It's either breakfast or lunch or somewhere in between, but don't rush off. Well, as we have an opportunity to give this morning, I was wondering whether we consider our giving to be faithful or fruitful. In John 15, verse 16, it says, "You didn't choose me, I chose you." This is Jesus speaking to you and I. "I appointed you to go and produce lasting fruit." And so we see that we are chosen and we are appointed to produce fruit. And our purpose is to have a lasting impact on those around us. And when we give, we can be faithful, but through that faithfulness, God is able to be fruitful. God's job is fruitfulness. Our job is simply faithfulness. So can I just take a moment and pray for us this morning? God, I thank you that you have called each one of us. You have appointed each one of us. You have gifted us and called us to a specific work. And I thank you, God, that we just need to be faithful. That is the only thing you ask of us, God, is faithfulness and fruitfulness we can leave in your hands. And as a beautiful, amazing congregation of people, together we said, amen, amen. If you are on the left-hand side of the seat, did that make sense? The left-hand seat of the side, you can grab the container, pass it along to the right, and let's watch church news.
Hey everyone, we are so glad that you've joined us here at church today. On behalf of our lead pastors, Sean and Tanya, we just want to say welcome. If you're here joining us for the very first time, why don't you grab a welcome pack as you exit the service? Inside, you'll find a small gift, a Connect card, and some more information about who we are. You can simply fill out the Connect card and drop it off at the info desk so that we can help you take your next steps in the life of the church. Are you ready to take your next steps and dive into the life of the church with us? That is what Growth Track is all about. It's your ticket to getting plugged in and making connections. Plus, you'll learn all about what makes Urban Edge tick. Best part, you can do it all online. Jump on over to our website and sign up today. Freedom Course helps you build the foundation of your faith in Jesus to help you embrace the truth of God's Word, your personal value to God, and your purpose in His kingdom. The course takes place over 12 weeks in small groups and culminates in our Freedom Encounter weekend. If you would like more information or to register, visit our website today. If you call Urban Edge your home, then join us for Team Night. Here you'll be equipped and empowered with God's Word and leadership lessons. We will be joined with special guest Pastor Trevor Coleman from Bridge Church, Alberton. RSVP on our website, and we'll see you there. I was down, but now I'm up.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Resurrection Sunday. It's a wonderful time to be in church together to celebrate Jesus Christ. And for those that are joining us online and in the overflow, we want to extend a warm welcome to you as well. So come on, let's give them a warm hand this morning. So we're going to be continuing our series this morning, Why Jesus? And the question that we need to ask today is this: why does the empty tomb matter? So can I ask you to stand with me this morning as we read our key text for today? It's found in Matthew chapter 27 from verse 1 to 7. It says this: "Now after the Sabbath, as it began to dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. Behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from the sky and came and rolled away the stone from the door and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. The angel answered the woman, 'Don't be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who has been crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, just like he said. Come, see the place where the Lord was lying. Go quickly and tell his disciples, he has risen from the dead, and behold, he goes before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you. The thing that I love about this portion of scripture is that the ladies were there, the guards were there, the angel appeared, and he rolls away the stone, not to let Jesus out, because Jesus had already risen. But he rolled the stone away so that they could see in that he was not there anymore. The tomb was empty. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that your word gives us new life, brings us healing, brings us refreshing. Thank you, Lord, this morning that you meet each and every one of us at our point of need. We commit ourselves into your hands. In Jesus' name, amen. Why don't you take your seats? I recall a very profound experience that I had quite a while back. In 2003, I was still working in the platinum mining industry. And the one particular day, the general manager secretary came to see me and she said, there's a family here from Israel. They're on their way to Sun City and they stopped at the mine and they were wondering, could I please help them with some information for their son about mining? He had to do a school project on mining. And so I said, of course, I'll help him. And so the lady and her son came into my office. I gave them some brochures and I explained the whole mining process to them. And while I was sitting there talking to them, I felt the Lord impress upon my heart to bless this lady with a gift. So my natural instinct was, let's see what's in my wallet. And so I still remember the desk was around about, you know, waist height, and I slipped my wallet out under the table like this, not to draw any attention to what I was doing. And I opened my wallet and I looked inside and there was 10 rand. So I thought to myself, well, what's 10 rand? You can't give somebody 10 rand. It's kind of like embarrassing. What can you do with 10 rand? And so I slipped my wallet back into my pocket again, and I was like thinking, well, what gift does God want me to give her? And then he drew my attention to something that was on my wall. It was a handcrafted, one-of-a-kind, and I mean one-of-a-kind. The guy passed away. He can't make another one. A one-of-a-kind handcrafted clock made out of wood, embossed, beautifully done. And there were only 8 ever made, and each one of the 8 was different. And they were gifts for people that had left a particular company that I worked for, and we each got one as a gift when we were transferred on promotion or whatever else. And so I'd received one of these clocks. No one had one like this. You can't buy it in a shop. And there it's on my wall, and the Lord says, I want you to give her that one-of-a-kind clock that you were waiting for years, and you got it up on your wall. I want you to give it to this lady. And in that moment, I didn't argue with God. I just obeyed God. I took the clock down, and I said to her, I want to bless you with this gift. And instinctively, she turned around. She said, no, you don't need to give me a gift. I said, no, I feel that God wants me to bless you. And her being Orthodox Jew, I made sure that I said, God wants to bless her, not Jesus, because she might have taken a bit of offense. I said, I feel God wants to bless you. And I gave her the clock, and she eventually received it. She then said to me, just wait, I want to get you something. She goes out, and she comes back in, and she brings me 2 little gifts. One was a bottle of olive oil, and the other was a pomegranate. So I looked at the gifts, and I smiled and said, well, thanks. I don't know what I'm going to do with the pomegranate other than eat it. I didn't understand in the moment the significance of the gifts that she was giving me, because the pomegranate for her was very important, being an Orthodox Jew. The pomegranate is one of the fruits that are found on the high priest's cloak. And the amount of seeds in that pomegranate that is grown in Israel is equivalent to the promises that God gave the Israelites in the Old Testament. So when she gave me that pomegranate, it had significant value to her, and she was actually proclaiming a blessing on me. That was 2003. Just before she left, I still remember speaking to God and saying, how I wish that I one day can go to Israel and walk in the footsteps of Jesus. Fast forward to 2004, I get transferred out of the mining side of our company, and now I'm working for the trust company, and our job is to develop the local community, to build houses, build schools, build infrastructure, do skills development. And one of the parts of our company was to create jobs. And so one of the jobs we created was a farm that would employ 240 people. We'd be supplying produce to all the big producers in South Africa. And so we decided to do things the proper way, and we brought an Israeli business partner on board, and he showed us alternative technology that they use in Israel because they're very successful in growing produce there. And so that's what happened. So we started this project. Fast forward another year to 2005. I'm still working in the trust, but I'm now attending Growth Point Church, Rustenburg Assembly of God, one of our churches. And we had our breakthrough conference coming up, and actually we had our founding pastor, Pastor Donovan Coetzee. He was going to be our first guest speaker, and we're going to have this breakthrough conference, and so we decided we want to make this special. So I said to the team, I've got a friend who works for CNN, and he's done correspondence for Fox News. He's got a studio in Joburg. We're going to get him to make our video clip for us to advertise this first breakthrough conference. So off we go to Joburg. We're sitting in the recording studio when I get a phone call. Mr. Ellish, we're just checking that all your paperwork is in order because you're going to Israel on a business trip, all expenses paid. And your boss asked us to phone you just to tell you that you are going, to confirm it, and we need to make sure your passport and everything's in order. Well, there we go, off to Israel. Totally unexpected. Don't just pass little comments to God. It seems to happen. There we arrive in Israel, and our business partner says, here's your itinerary for the whole period of time, all the companies, all the farms we're going to be visiting. And he said, and Ed, now remember, my Israeli business partner is an Orthodox Jew. He says, I know that you're a Christian, so I've arranged that we are going to go to some of the significant landmarks associated with Jesus. And one of those landmarks was the tomb. And I still remember when my colleague and myself, Charles, we walked into that tomb. I cannot describe in words. It is actually indescribable. You're standing inside the tomb. You're looking at the place that Jesus lay, and you're completely overwhelmed. We were just like looking at each other. It's like your mouth's hanging open. You don't know whether you should say something or not. You just go silent. But the thing that hit me the most was after we stood there for a while and we made our way out of the tomb. As we went out of the tomb, I looked up and there was a wooden plaque on the top there, and it said, he's not here, for he's risen. Now I know that Jesus is alive. But when that happened, it messed so badly with me. We sat there crying because the reality just hit us again. This is real. Jesus isn't here. He has risen. He has paid the price for each and every one of us. Now, research shows us that there's more than 4,200 religions in the world. Everybody is vying for your attention. Our way is the right way. If you do what we believe, everything's going to be okay. But the question you need to ask yourself is, what makes Christianity different from all the other religions in the world? And the answer is an empty tomb, the resurrection. That's what sets us apart. The fact that Jesus took our sins upon himself, the fact that he died on a cross for us, and the fact that he came back to life. Now, when it comes to other religions, they make pilgrimages to grave sites of their religious leaders. But when it comes to us, we go to our site, which is an empty tomb. That's the hope that we have. Our God has risen. Jesus is alive. He is not there. He has risen. And how do we know this? If you look throughout the Bible, you look throughout history, you'll see that there's at least 12 times that reference is made to the fact that people witnessed that Jesus was alive after he was crucified. That after 3 days, in fact, he did rise from the dead. And so this morning, I first want to just take a look at some of these historic moments. The first one is after the Sabbath to Mary Magdalene, John chapter 20, verse 11 to 18. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've put him, and I will get him." And Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. In that moment, she knew Jesus was alive. Then there's another example, the woman returning from the tomb. Matthew 20, starting at verse 28, starting from verse 9. Suddenly Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshipped. It was an instinctive thing to do. The moment they saw Jesus, they began to worship him. And then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." And then, of course, Jesus appears to Peter. Luke chapter 24, verse 34. They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." And then a well-known one on the road to Emmaus, Luke chapter 24 from verse 28. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he was going further. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening, the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with him, he took bread, just like we did today, and gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. Then there's another time when the disciples were gathered together, an evening without Thomas being present. In John chapter 20 from verse 19, that evening, the disciples were meeting behind locked doors in fear of the Jewish leaders, when suddenly Jesus was standing there among them. After greeting them, he showed them his hands and side, and how wonderful was their joy as they saw their Lord. And then 8 days later, this time the same group of people, but this time Thomas is with them. John chapter 20 from verse 26. 8 days later, the disciples were again together, and this time Thomas was with them. The doors were locked, but suddenly, as before, Jesus was standing among them and greeting them. Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger into my hands, put your hand into my side. Don't be faithless any longer, believe. My Lord and my God," Thomas said. I want you to notice those last two scriptures that I read to you. It says that the building was closed. The doors were locked. They were trying to protect themselves from the religious leaders of the day. But it says suddenly Jesus was there. He didn't open the door. It just says he came through. He was there. He was present. The same way he moved out of the tomb. Didn't need the stone to be rolled away for him to exit the tomb. He just left the tomb. Why? Because Jesus is God. 3 weeks later, he appears again to the disciples on the shores of Galilee. John 21, verse 4 onwards, it says, "Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, 'Friends, haven't you any fish?' 'No,' they answered. He said, 'Throw your net on the right side of the boat and you will find some.' When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, 'It is the Lord.' Assuming Simon Peter heard him say, 'It is the Lord,' he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off and jumped into the water." He couldn't contain himself. "I've just got to get to Jesus." And then to the 11 on a mountain in Galilee, Matthew chapter 28 from verse 16. "Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted." He has a big one. He appears to more than 500 people in Galilee. 1 Corinthians 15:6. "After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep." You see, some people could have said, "Well, he appeared to the disciples." Well, obviously the disciples are all, you know, they're in this together, they're colluding together, they're making this all up. But he has a picture where 500 people are together and he shows himself again. I recently read this article by Lee Strobel. Now, Lee Strobel, he's born again today, but he used to be an atheist. And initially, Lee Strobel set out to disprove everything about Jesus. And the one particular day, he goes to his psychologist. He says, "I went to my psychologist friend and I said, 'If 500 people claimed to see Jesus after he died, it was just a hallucination.' He said, 'Hallucinations are an individual event. If 500 people have the same hallucination, that's a bigger miracle than the resurrection.'" So there's his theory gone right there. And then in 1 Corinthians 15:7, we see he also appeared to James and then to all the apostles. And then the one that I love the most, at his ascension, Luke chapter 24, verse 50 onwards, "Jesus led his disciples out to Bethany, where he raised his hands and blessed them. As he was doing this, he left and he was taken up into heaven." Imagine this. Not only do they get to witness that Jesus has risen from the dead, but while Jesus is busy blessing them, they get to witness him ascending to be with his Father in heaven as well. And then, of course, Paul on the road to Damascus, Acts chapter 9, verse 3 to 6. When Saul had almost reached Damascus, remember, Paul was Saul before his conversion. Is that right? Paul was Saul before his conversion. That's right. When Saul had almost reached Damascus, a bright light from heaven suddenly flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying, "Saul, Saul, why are you so cruel to me?" "Who are you?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus," the Lord answered. "I am the one you are so cruel to. Now get up and go into the city where you will be told what to do. And the rest, of course, is history, because he receives Jesus Christ as Lord and he goes out and he proclaims the good news. Now, what do we learn from all of these scriptures? Well, firstly, what's most important is more than 500 people witnessed that Jesus rose from the dead. The second thing is that he was seen and heard many times over a period of 40 days. It wasn't just like in one day people said, oh, we heard Jesus. No, over a period of 40 days, Jesus had revealed himself and spoken to people. And thirdly, that even those inclined to doubt, like Thomas, received proof. It's also important to note that all the records agreed that Jesus spoke audibly, that he ate food, and that he appeared as flesh and bone, that Jesus could reason, that he could instruct with intelligence, and that his words and mannerisms were as before. I mean, just think of it for a moment. He told the same thing. He told them to do the same thing before when he said, just throw your nets on the other side, and you got that big haul of fish. Now he tells them that again. Same mannerism, same language, same Jesus. The other thing that's important is that the witnesses showed surprise and joy and other emotions upon getting a revelation that they were standing in the midst of the risen Christ. And that tells us that these accounts were real. They were not made up in advance. But let's get back to answering that very important question. Why does the empty tomb matter? And this morning, I want to share four reasons with you. And the first one is the resurrection cancels out our sins. The fact is that each and every one of us sitting here was born with a death sentence. It's kind of like you're born with a one-way ticket that says you're going to hell, eternal separation from God. But Jesus intervenes because of this. Someone that had never sinned before and said, I don't want you to have that sort of inheritance. I want to step in and pay the price for you so that you can have an eternity with hope. And so that Jesus, who knows no sin, dies for us. And his blood becomes the final sacrifice for all of our sins. It's not like the blood of the animals like in the Old Testament where the blood just covered your sin. This blood has wiped out your sin, taken it away completely. Whether we believe that or not doesn't change the fact that it's actually happened. Jesus paid the price in full. And that brings us back into a right relationship with God. In Romans 3:25, God gave him as a sacrifice. When people believe in him, his blood pays for the wrong things they have done. This shows that God is good and right. He was right when he forgave the wrong things that people did long ago. Here's the thing. His resurrection defeated sin's hold on you and I. His resurrection resulted in our sins being completely forgiven once and for all. And that's an act of unconditional love. Unconditional love says, I love you whether or not you're going to receive it. God had no guarantee that we were going to reciprocate that love. I want you to consider this for a moment. If Jesus had to wait for us to reciprocate any love before he gave his life for us, we'd still be waiting for a savior. But he said, I'm going to love you in spite of whatever you choose to do with that love. It was also an act of grace and mercy. Grace being unmerited favor. In other words, I'm just going to bless you. You don't have to tick boxes. You need to jump through hoops. I'm just going to bless you. Unmerited favor. But the Bible also teaches us that that was an act of mercy. And mercy is different to grace. Mercy is you deserve death, but I'm going to give you the opposite of what you deserve. That is unconditional love. In Colossians 2:13-14, when you were dead in your sins, you were not set free from the sinful things of the world. But God forgave your sins and gave you new life through Christ. We had broken the law many times. Those sins were held against us by the law. That law had writings which said we were sinners. But now he has destroyed that writing by nailing it to the cross. And that is the beauty of Christianity. That we experience forgiveness for all of our sins. It doesn't matter who you are, what you've done, or where you've been, or what anyone else has ever said about you, the price has been paid in full for all of our sins. Because Jesus canceled the record of all sins by nailing it to the cross. And then he rose again so that we can be set free once and for all. Lewis Drummond says this, Forgiveness transcends finite human reason. The mere thought that one's entire sin account can be utterly eradicated is staggering. Yet it is quite clear that the forgiveness of sin strikes at the very core of human need and experience. It speaks of guilt gone, remorse removed, depression disappearing, and emptiness of life eradicated. What power there is in forgiveness. And it all comes abundantly from the gracious hand of God. Unconditional love for you and for me. There's a second thing. The resurrection connects us to God. Now, if you look at the many religions out there in the world today, you'll find that God is represented as impersonal or distant or unapproachable. But the Bible teaches us that our God is inclusive and not exclusive. He doesn't say if you do, you're going to be accepted. He's inclusive. Everyone is welcome because our God is loving, He's inviting, and He is accessible to everyone that is willing to receive His Son Jesus as Lord. That's the beauty of the resurrection. It bridged the gap between our sin and God's holiness, creating a way for us to connect to God again through Jesus and through the price that Jesus paid for you and I on the cross. Now, this is important. When Jesus died on the cross, it tells us that the temple veil was ripped in two. Now, there was a place called the Holy of Holies. Nobody could go in there except in the high priest. And so everyone else had to stand on the other side of the veil. Only the high priest could go into the presence of God behind the veil. But when Jesus was crucified, that veil was ripped in two, giving everyone access into the presence of God. And now the presence of God no longer resides behind a veil. But the presence of God comes to reside in us. We become the temple of the living God once we invite Jesus into our lives, once we accept that He died on the cross and that He rose again for us. You see, Jesus made a way for us to connect with God, to have an intimate, personal relationship with Him. In Matthew 27, verse 50 onwards says, "And Jesus cried out again with a loud, agonized voice and gave up His spirit, voluntary, sovereignly dismissing and releasing His spirit from His body in submission to His Father's plan. And at once the veil of the Holy of Holies of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks were split apart." Because the veil has been removed, you and I can talk with God, we can worship God, and we can pray with God. And because Jesus rose from the dead, we have direct access to Him. And we are put into right standing with God through what Jesus did on the cross and the fact that He rose again. I love this quote by Max Lucado. He says, "The next time you find yourself alone in a dark alley facing the undeniables of life, don't cover them with a blanket or ignore them with a nervous grin. Don't turn up the TV and pretend they aren't there. Instead, stand still, whisper His name and listen. He is nearer than you think." Whether you're at home, cooking food, washing dishes, driving in your car, at work, He's closer than you realize. You have access to Him. And it only requires this, that you open your mouth and speak to Him, that you have a conversation with Him. He's closer than you think. He's not a distant God. He's present with us every day. There's a third thing. The resurrection confirms that Jesus is alive. The resurrection proves that He is God, that everything that He ever claimed is true, that He is who He said He was and is, that He's alive. Now, over the years, many prophets and teachers have claimed many things, but only Jesus defeated death by rising from the dead. And as I've said before, we're the only religion in the world that has an empty tomb. The only one. This is confirmed in Matthew 28:6. "But He isn't here, for He has come back to life again, just as He said He would. Come in and see where His body was lying." And again in Revelation chapter 1, verse 18, "When I saw Him, I fell at His feet as dead. But He laid His right hand on me and said, 'Don't be afraid. Though I am the first and last, the living one who died, who is now alive forevermore, who has the keys of hell and death, don't be afraid. Yeah, we have John who wrote the book of Revelation and he has this encounter with Jesus. And when he sees Jesus, he's overwhelmed and falls down to his feet. And right there, Jesus offers him comfort and assurance. But that comfort and assurance is not just for John. It's for you and I as well. Because he assures John of his sovereignty over death and eternal everlasting life. Now, over the years, there have been many skeptics, people that have tried to explain the empty tomb away. Some people have said, oh, we found the bones of Jesus. I need to find out afterwards. It's just a whole lot of rubbish. But there have been many skeptics. One of those skeptics was a man named Frank Morrison. He wanted to write an argument, actually wanted to write a book with this argument inside that would disprove the resurrection. And so he sets out on this mission to prove his case. And guess what? On his journey, his eyes are opened. He tried his best to disprove the empty tomb. But on his journey, he has a God encounter. And instead of writing a book disproving the resurrection, he wrote a book entitled, Who Moved the Stone? In defense of the empty tomb. I don't know how many of you are old enough to remember the Watergate scandal. Any of you remember the Watergate scandal? It happened in the 70s. President Richard Nixon, a whole lot of guys did some criminal things and eventually the president had to resign. Well, there was a quote written by a man named Charles Colson. And he says this, I know the resurrection is a fact and Watergate proved it to me. How? Because 12 men testified they'd seen Jesus raised from the dead and then proclaimed their truth for over 40 years, never once denying it. Everyone was beaten, tortured, stoned, and put in prison. They would not have endured it if they weren't true. Watergate embroiled 12 of the most powerful men in the world, including the American president. And they couldn't keep a lie for 3 weeks. You're telling me that 12 apostles could keep a lie for 40 years? Absolutely impossible. There's a fourth one. Without the resurrection, there would be no hope. You see, this is the hope that we have as believers, that Jesus beat death, that his resurrection proves that he is who he said he is, that his death paid for our sin, and his rising means that we are forgiven in full. It also tells us that we can have courage, that we can stand tall because Jesus is alive. And by receiving Jesus, Lord, also changes the way that you and I live. I love what Jesus says to John in Revelation 21:5. And the one sitting on the throne said, see, I am making all things new. And then he said to me, write this down, for what I tell you is trustworthy and true. Whenever I read that portion of scripture that says, I'm making all things new, it reminds me of the passion of the Christ. And it's the right statement. It is out of context in the passion of the Christ. But it shows you Jesus carrying the cross. He keeps falling down, breaking down, and he keeps on picking it up. Pain and suffering. And in a moment, his mother runs to him. And he says, look, mother, I make all things new. Jesus came to sacrifice his life for you and for me. It is the greatest love story that has ever been told. See, in Christ alone, we get a clean slate, a fresh start, and a new beginning. People don't want to give you a second chance. People will only focus on your faults. But Jesus says, I want to focus on you because I love you. I've paid a price for you. My blood has washed you clean once and for all. J.I. Packer says this, optimism is a wish without warrant. Christian hope is a certainty, guaranteed by God himself. Optimism reflects ignorance as to whether good things will ever actually happen. Christian hope expresses knowledge that every day of his life and every moment beyond it, the believer can say with truth, on the basis of God's own commitment, that the best is yet to come. I want to close with a story. It's found in the book of John, In the book of John, it tells you about when they go into the tomb, they found the burial clothes thrown aside. But the cloth that was over the head of Jesus was neatly folded and put to a separate side. And you might ask yourself, well, what's the significance of that? John 20:6-7 says this, then following him, Simon Peter arrived and went into the tomb and saw the strips of linen lying there. He also saw the cloth that had been around Jesus' head, which was folded up and laid in a different place from the strips of linen. Now, to understand the significance of the cloth, you need to understand Hebrew tradition of that day. What would happen is, and this is about the servant and his master. The servant would prepare the master's table, put out all the things that he would like on his dinner table, that he would like on the table, and all these foods and all that stuff. He'd put everything out for him, getting ready to serve him. The master would then come to the table and begin to eat. And while he's eating, the servant had to disappear. He wasn't allowed to be visible, but he would be visible enough to be able to see when the master was finished. And once the master had finished eating, what he would do is he'd take a cloth, he would wipe his fingers, he would wipe his mouth, he would wipe his beard. And then he would take that cloth and he would throw it aside. And that meant, I'm done eating. And the servant would then run in immediately and he'd go and clean up everything and pack everything away again. But if the master got up from the table and he folded the cloth up neatly and he put it back down again, it meant something else. It meant, don't touch the table. Why? Because the folded napkin meant, I'm coming back. What happened in that moment wasn't just an empty tomb that Jesus had risen, but there was a promise in the tomb that said, I'm coming back. And the question is, who's Jesus coming back for? For everyone that has accepted him as Lord and Savior of their lives. Can I ask you to close your eyes and bow your heads for a moment? We know that Jesus is coming back. And we know who he's coming back for. The fact is, Jesus has paid the price for all of our sin, whether we accept that or not. But the ones he's coming back for are the ones that have invited him into their lives. The Bible teaches us that Jesus died on the cross for us and that with his blood he paid the full price for all our sin. What should our response be to that? Because God's plan for us to reconcile with him is to accept his son Jesus, to accept that he died on the cross for us, to accept that he paid the full price with his blood, and to accept that he rose again from the dead. When we accept that and we confess that with our mouths, then we come back into right standing with God. We get a fresh start and a new beginning because Jesus then becomes Lord of our lives. And the moment that I invite Jesus into my life, something wonderful happens. That same Holy Spirit that departed from the temple in the Old Testament when the veil was ripped in two, that same Holy Spirit comes to live in a new temple. And that temple is you. Your body becomes the temple of the living God when you accept Jesus as Lord. And with the Holy Spirit in me, I get a fresh start, a new beginning. With the Holy Spirit in me, he begins to change and transform me, renew me, make me whole. But it starts with a surrendered life to Jesus. And so this morning, if you've never invited Jesus into your life, or maybe you have, but you've been distant from God, for whatever the reason, I want to invite you to pray this prayer with me today, to invite Jesus into your life, to embrace a fresh start and a new beginning with God. But it starts by asking Jesus to be Lord. If that's you, I want to invite you to pray with me right now. And you can just pray quietly where you are sitting. And you can repeat with me. Father, I come to you this morning in Jesus' name. You know me, you know all my shortcomings, you know all my weaknesses and all my failures, you know all my sin, but I thank you that you receive me as I am, but you committed to not leaving me as I am. because your word says that through Jesus, I get a fresh start and a new beginning. Through Jesus, I have hope again. So, Father, this morning, I choose to embrace your gift of love, who is Jesus. Jesus, I invite you into my life. I ask you to be my Lord and Savior from this day forward. I thank you that you died on the cross for me, and that with your blood, you paid the full price for all of my sin. I believe that God raised you from the dead. I invite you now, be my Lord and be my Savior from this day forward. And Holy Spirit, I invite you to come and live in me and to make my body a holy temple to my Father in heaven. In Jesus' name. While the eyes are still closed and the heads are still bowed, if you prayed that prayer, whether it's a first time or a recommitment, can I ask you just to slip your hand up? I want to acknowledge you, and you can put your hand down again if that's you. I see your hand. I see your hand. 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 There's hands going up all over. See your hands at the back. See your hands over here on the right. Yeah, in the front. See your hands over there. Thank you. You can put your hands down. If you haven't put your hand up yet and you'd still like to and you pray that prayer, I want to give one more opportunity. Just slip up your hand. I'll acknowledge you, and you can put it down again. Is there anyone else? I see your hand. I see your hand. See your hand. See your hand. See your hand at the back there. Father, we thank you for every hand that's gone up this morning. Father, we thank you. You make all things new. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, let's give God a hand this morning. If you responded by putting up your hand, the seat pocket in front of you, there's a connect card. Can I invite you to take that out, to fill it in? And you can hand it in at the info desk on your way out. And during the week, somebody's just going to reach out to you. We're not going to harass you. Just going to connect with you, see how you're doing, and help you take your next steps in your decision to have Jesus as Lord of your life. God bless you. Don't run off. Come and join us outside in the cafe for great coffee and great connection.